Hello, this is Business Live from BBC News with Susanna Streeter and Sally Bundock.
Alitalia flies again with government help, but will Italy's flagship carrier ever manage to land on its own 2 feet?
Live from London, that's our top story on Monday the 16th of October. Carrier managed to avoid today's deadline for rescue offers, but what does it tell us about the fate of Europe's many troubled airlines? Also in the programme, weighing up political risk in Europe, Austria elects the world's youngest leader, Theresa May hopes for a Brexit breakthrough, and Catalonia's leader seeks talks with Spain. We'll talk you through what's at stake. And is all that political uncertainty affecting investor sentiment? This is the picture in Europe as markets have opened, the FTSE up very slightly, but Spain's IBEX down 0.77%. Sally.
And would you pay to use an airport lounge? Access to often perk for business or first-class travellers. But with more of us looking to travel on the cheap, we're speaking to the man who's trying to pamper us before we set off. And today we're asking the question, after a potato shortage is hitting New Zealand, sparking a crisp crisis there, how much you'd be willing to pay for a packet of crisps? Can you live without them? Just use the hashtag BBCBizLive.
Welcome to Business Live. Europe's airlines are struggling like never before. Three have gone into administration this year alone, and one of those, Alitalia, is up for sale. But the big question is, can anyone save Italy's national flag carrier? The airline currently flies to over 80 destinations around the world, and its fate is being closely watched. Bids for the airline were coming to an end today, but thanks to yet another last-ditch intervention from the government, it's been given more time. Now, in February this year, Alitalia had debts of around $3.3 billion. 3 months later, it went into special administration after employees rejected a rescue plan that included a wage cut in return for a cash injection from shareholders. Alitalia's main shareholder is UAE's Etihad, which owns 49% of the airline. But Etihad was also the key shareholder in Air Berlin, which filed for insolvency in August after Etihad withdrew its financial support. So, who might be interested in snapping up Alitalia? Well, Ryanair had planned a bid for the airline, but that came to an abrupt end after Ryanair was forced to focus its efforts on dealing with the fallout from cancelling thousands of flights. But maybe Lufthansa could come to the rescue. Germany's flagship carrier said last week that it would be interested in creating a new Alitalia. Lufthansa is also buying up parts of Air Berlin to expand its Eurowings budget airline business. Sally.
Thanks, Susanna. Well, let's get the view of Daniel Roska, Senior European Transportation Analyst at the investment firm Sanford C. Bernstein. Good to see you. Good morning. So what do you think may happen? I feel like I've talked about Alitalia nearly on the edge of bankruptcy for my entire career.
And that's very true, and I think, you know, the three parties we've seen most interested, Lufthansa, EasyJet and Cerberus, all have said they'd be looking to buy parts of Alitalia, but not in the shape it's in today. So I think that's really what's keeping them from making the deal right now.
It'll what's attractive to them? What do they want?
Well, the Italian market still is the fifth largest market in Europe. You've got a great center around Milan, so there are valuable passengers there. It's just a market in a structure that is not very profitable, especially at the cost position Alitalia is at.
Also, though, the airline itself has only made a profit once, hasn't it? In 1 year, 1998, I think, since it was founded in the 1940s. I mean, the way the airline has been run over the years has not been profitable or efficient by any means.
Absolutely not. But that is, again, as you look at it, cost position for an airline is the one and only thing you need to worry about first and foremost. And that's really what you need to change on that airline.
And it's interesting, isn't it? It's come to a time when today we're even having the last few Monarch passengers repatriated after the airline collapsed. It shows just what a state, really, the airline industry is right across Europe. It's very hard, isn't it? There's simply too much capacity, do you think?
Well, there's too much capacity. If you look at it, the top 20 airline groups in Europe control 90% of the inter-European market. In US, the number is 6. And that really shows you the amount of market concentration we don't have in Europe that makes it so very tough. There's far too much capacity, and that is, of course, driving out Alitalia, Monarch, but also Air Berlin and the likes, and basically separating the market into two camps, right? The big five, where you have Lufthansa, Air France, IAG, EasyJet, and Ryanair, and, say, the bottom of state-owned flag carriers that are slowly going to die.
I'm sure Brussels is watching this very closely, especially if Lufthansa were to sort of put its oar in, as it were, because, of course, it's buying up quite a bit of Air Berlin. There's going to be competition issues, isn't there?
Well, for Lufthansa, this is especially true for the intra-Germany market. Remember, for the majority of European travel, you have still a lot of options. You can connect to other hubs. So if Lufthansa were to buy it, Alitalia, I actually think this could be less stressful on a competitive view than Air Berlin, for example. Remember, Ryanair is the largest Italian carrier with about 30% of the market.
Interesting. Yeah. We've got to keep an eye on it. We will keep an eye on it. Thank you, Daniel, for coming in.
Definitely.
Perhaps chat
pleasure.
To you again about this in the future.
Particularly with all the repercussions for Ryanair, shortage of pilots. It's a topic that there don't seem to be any easy answers to.
No. Now let's have a look at some of the other stories making the news in business today. Here in the UK, the head of the regulator, the Financial Conduct Authority, is warning of a pronounced build-up of debt among young people. Andrew Bailey told the BBC young people were increasingly having to borrow to meet the basic costs of living. The regulator also said he did not like some high-cost lending schemes and that credit should be more affordable.
Shares in Japan's third-largest steelmaker, Kobe Steel, have fallen another 3%, which means that more than $2 billion has been wiped off the value of the company. It's all because it admitted that it had falsified data about the quality of some of its metal products. More than 500 companies have used them around the world, including in cars and planes.
And the Airbus chief executive, Tom Enders, has said he would be prepared to step down if he was no longer part of the solution as the firm deals with ongoing corruption probes. The aircraft maker has been under investigation in the UK and France since 2016 when it admitted using middlemen in plane sales. Mr. Enders said he saw no reason to resign, but added he would be ready to do so if needed. The Airbus board said last week it had full confidence in Mr. Enders.
Okay, let's check in with the financial markets now. And it's been another day of record-breaking. Tokyo's Nikkei hit another 21-year high. India's Sensex also hit a record earlier, but retreated a little due to some profit-taking. Hong Kong shares also very positive, up by just under 1%, tracking gains on Wall Street. On Friday, the tech-heavy Nasdaq reached another record, and strong retail sales pushed up the Dow to gain for the fifth week in a row. Well, let's take a look now at the situation in Europe at the moment. Investors are weighing up political risk after a 31-year-old looks likely to become Austria's next leader. Sebastian Kurz is projected to come first in yesterday's poll to elect a new chancellor. Also, Theresa May is heading to Brussels later to meet EU leaders in a bid to try and end the stalemate over Brexit. I think it's a bit of a wait-and-see approach, really, for the FTSE 100 at the moment. The DAX in Frankfurt and the CAC are just about in positive territory. So after yet another rise on Friday, Michelle Fleury now has all of the details about what's ahead on Wall Street today.
Wall Street's newest darling Netflix reports third quarter earnings later this Monday. And a measure of its success will depend on how many subscribers it added in the quarter. Investors view this as a gauge of the company's growth. Now, Goldman Sachs is predicting that the firm added around 1 million new subscribers in the US in the last 3 months and over 4 million internationally. The home of House of Cards and Narcos has been spending heavily on new shows like Ozarks and acquiring the rights to others as it tries to lure viewers away from traditional cable TV. To help pay for that, Netflix recently raised the price for some of its subscription plans in the United States. And investors are betting this latest strategy won't scare off customers. On Friday, shares in the world's biggest online video streaming service hit an all-time high.
That's Michelle Fleury. Well, we've got Sue Nofka with us, UK Equities Fund Manager at Schroders. Lovely to see you, Sue. So, Susanna and Michelle outlining, it's a pretty busy week. There's a lot going on. There's a lot to watch out for. And on top of that, you've got these markets just going up and up and up.
Yeah, lots of record highs. I think what we're seeing is investors liking this synchronized global growth and activity. We've seen that come underlined by the IMF. talking about raising their global growth forecast both this year and next year. And it's not just dominated by one region. And that's really helped calm investors in the face of some tightening of monetary policy compared to the very loose conditions.
Interesting as well, in that IMF report, it did say that the only region, the only country it was downgrading growth was the UK, and today we have Theresa May heading to Brussels to try and restart the Brexit negotiations. That really is key, isn't it, for the UK economy's prospects?
For the economy, that's true. For the stock market, global growth, of course, carries much more weight than the local economy.
Yeah, especially for the FTSE 100, which is very, very international. The other sort of person in focus will be tomorrow, will be Mark Carney. He's before the Treasury Select Committee, the Governor of the Bank of England. And a lot of central banks have been talking over the weekend, Janet Yellen talking on Sunday. They're all sort of focused on inflation and where it might be headed. We've got inflation out tomorrow in the UK as well. It's a real issue, isn't it, in the UK?
It is, because you've got this disconnect between headline and core. And the same is true in the States, where energy costs and exchange rate movements have really boosted the headline level of inflation here in the UK. So we're going to see a number that's around 3%. That's a full percentage point ahead of what the Bank of England's target is. That could incur Mark Carney writing a letter to the government. So there's quite a lot at stake. He's also outlined the fact that he'd quite like to put interest rates up as long as the data is supported. So we'll have to see what that data holds this week.
Yeah, and also this week, you know, there's a lot of corporate earnings out as well. Japan's Nikkei on a high. It seems as though investors are really confident, really, about the prospects for global companies and the returns that they're making.
That's right. So this broad-based, quite sustainable economic growth that we're seeing is translating into corporate profitability. And that